Once a progressive movement, now the new norm. Homeschooling or home-based learning has become the new way of life, whether we like it or not. But how do you set up a solid foundation for success? Now joining us with us, Once a progressive movement, now the new norm, homeschooling or home-based learning has become the new way of life, whether we like it or not. But how do you set up a solid foundation for success? Now with us now to talk more about this is Dr. Donna Simpao, a homeschooling mom of four kids for 17 years now and the president of the Homeschool Association of the Philippines. Thank you for being with us, Dr. Simpao.
Hello, thank you for having me. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Simpao, you guys were ahead of the curve here. 17 years of experience as opposed to our near nothing. Now we are parents come educators. What's the first thing we need to do to set this up for success?
I think the very first thing is that we should understand what's happening and take a breath, you know, just breathe. And try to find a way on accepting the situation. You know, 4 weeks ago, we had heard a lot of not very good experiences of parent teachers who were forced to do this. And it became a very source of conflict, friction, stress, because of suddenly they were thrusted into being parent teachers without ample time, support, adjustment, plus the fact that we were going through the beginnings of the pandemic with all the uncertainties that is and the unknowns that it's offering. It's just too much of a tall order to expect everything to go smoothly. So I think my advice is just, education has its way of getting back, you know, finding a way back. So I think it's very good first to prepare ourselves for this, not to dive and delve and get ourselves into it without preparing ourselves as parents and parent teachers. Yeah.
Okay, break it up. Yeah. There's a lot going on. A lot of us were just thrust into the home. A lot of people have, you know, have this lull, and you know, a lot of people are losing their jobs. A lot of people have other concerns. Now, how do you strike a balance? How do you find a right dynamic that's going to suit your family?
Okay, it really depends on where they are, because a lot of the children started in June and they ended in March. And so there was what you call the mass passing, you know, and there are people who are actually now in their summer. There are, however, who started in August and are still finishing their workload right now. So at this moment, you know, I'm just hoping and expecting that schools are actually doing their part, not just to, you know, just to deliver the learning, but to support the parents on how to do it. You know, this is not the business as usual. There's just too much going on. And maybe with the help of the guidance counselors and the moderators and, you know, parents can be supported. So I'm talking to those who are still finishing their school year. However, since we know that this might not really let up for a while, so there are people who are actually considering homeschooling through the summer or even thinking of doing it for the longer haul. That's
okay. Now, for those people that want to get into it, you know, a lot of people don't have that choice. They're in it full throttle now, whether they like it or not. What online or physical resources can you recommend to them?
Okay, so this in homeschooling, we have what you call the independent homeschoolers and the homeschoolers who actually enroll with a institution, which we call homeschool providers. These are institutions, organizations that support parents with training, material, curriculum, advice, even blended learning using, you know, tech support. However, we know that the private schools or even public schools might dip their hands into home-based programs as well. So there would be a lot of communication probably from the private schools which you are enrolled with, that they may offer homeschool programs. And I am just hoping that as they do this, they also empower the parents with the training that is needed to become a home parent teacher. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. It opens up, it paves the way for a new relationship with a child, from parent to child, now it's educator and student. How do you prepare the parent and the child for this change in dynamic and this shifting of roles?
Okay, if the child is mature enough, I mean, if can understand what's happening, what a pandemic is, it, there really is an importance of in sitting down and realizing what the situation is and being aware of everything, and that you have to say, as a family, we have decided that this is what we're going to do. Mommy or daddy will become the teacher, and you can actually draw from the children and ask, what are the best qualities of your teachers? You know, how can mommy become a better facilitator? How can I become a better teacher? You know, it cannot be that you'll just come in and say, hey, I'm the teacher now, you follow me, and you know, you do what I do. I mean, teachers right now are not any more providers of information. They're considered facilitators. You're just, the information is all out there. You're just drawing it. You're just finding ways to use it. And there's so much more that a teacher now can do rather than just giving out the facts and giving out the material.
Okay. Yeah. As the teacher, what are you supposed to do and what are you not supposed to do to make this a stress-free, conflict-free relationship?
Oh, that's a very, very big question, because it all, of course, I've always said, or I've always read in research that one of the biggest influence in the success of an education, of educating a child, lies on the teacher, the qualities of the teacher, the skill set of the teacher. So if parents will just remember that and say, am I willing to be taught? Am I willing to be taught how to be a teacher? Do I have teachable traits so I can adjust myself and become a better parent teacher? Then that's one, you know, to improve yourself on that area of parent teaching. Then you have to figure out, what are you going to teach? The curriculum. This may be provided by the school if you are enrolled with them, or a provider if you're enrolled with them. But if you're an independent homeschooling, you can pretty much set up your own, you can change and tweak everything that can probably be according to the relevant times, what's happening out there, the interest of the child, the family issues. You know, there's so much you can work with. So it really depends. So you have the teacher and you have the material that you're going to teach.
All right. I see the pros: flexible, personalized learning, safe from the clutches of COVID-19, which is what everybody's looking out for right now. What's a typical homeschooling schedule like, and how are the days structured? You know, they're varying age groups, so maybe we can break it down.
Yes. Okay. This really depends on many factors, like parents, what are their available times? Are they working? Are they working from home? And then what are the age of the children? Are there children that still nap? You know, are there children that wake up late? So the best is to find a time that both parent and children are at their best. They're not cranky, they're not tired, they're not, you know, at their best, because that's when you give your best, is when you teach and when they learn. So for small children, they say, which is about maybe 5 years old and below, a 45-minute unhurried time of play, of reading, of music and movement, of just being together with sort of a plan, you know, some games or play-based activities. It could be 45 minutes to 1 hour. However, primary years, because you have a lot of drills, you have a lot of reading, you have a lot of all of those, what they call the grammar stage of just putting the foundation in, it could be from 2 to 3 hours. And then the upper years can be from 4 to 6 hours. It really depends as well, because in a regular school, you have 40 kids to one teacher, right? And learning pretty much happens in 40 minutes blocks. A 40-minute topic or a lesson can be learned by a homeschool student on a one-on-one setup for like 10 minutes. So you can explore more, you can proceed further, and you know, it works. So you have less time. You have less time that is needed to do the learning. Yeah.
Speaking of time, is it a typical 5 days a week? What are the recommended hours?
Oh,
bare minimum.
Okay. Well, of course, children thrive through routine. You don't want to be haphazard or no structure. Although some are like that. That's what you call the unschoolers. They thrive in some sort of less structured way. I did it for 5 days, but then I would take a day that was maybe Friday. I did it, like, I would end at noon, and I would do my, of course, I would do my exercise, my self-care, finish or not finish. So some would do a midweek break. Some would not do a Monday because weekends are always tough, especially for many children and small children. So they rest on a Monday. So some would do a 3-day work or 4-day work. Some would do 5 days. So it really also depends
really
on you.
Tailor fit for your family.
Yes. Yes.
For the
yes.
individuals involved, the parent, the children.
Yes.
For those in a different family circumstance, for those that have parents that must work, both of
yes.
them, for those that have parents that either have to be physically at work or have to work from home, is there hope? Can you have a fruitful, beneficial, successful relationship given the demands of work in addition to the demands of being a teacher to your children?
Yes. Again, it depends on the type of work. Again, it depends on the age of the children. Of course, we know that the younger they are, the more supervision they need, the more guidance they need. However, we do have independent learners from grade 3s, 4s, 5s, wherein they can be left with work and the parent comes home to just do sort of like a discussion with them. And I've seen that personally with someone who had an 8-to-4 job and homeschooled the children from 5 to 7 and about 8 to 10 p.m. And the children woke up late and there was a support system and they were able to do it. And they're now all graduates of Ateneo and La Salle and they're fine. However, there are, you know, there's always a give and take. So not everyone is called to do the way we homeschool, wherein one parent is home. Not everyone has that that chance to do it. But there are certain tweaks that can be done. And
okay.
that's why it's good to really assess and weigh everything first before deciding.
As a parent, yes. what are the certain qualities or characteristics or behaviors that you need to hone within yourself in order to be a better teacher for your children?
For a homeschooler parent, since we're not educators by training, you know, we need to have that curiosity. We need to have that creativity. We need to have that open mind to learn on what is the best, what are the most, you know, modern ways to teach right now. How do you know your children are learning? We have to really understand that process and be open to learn all the time. And of course, the number two would be patience. Patience is a virtue.
If you could buy it, bottle it, and drink it, right?
Patience, yes.
Okay, now Dr. Simpao, in terms of socialization, how in homeschooling and home-based learning, how do you address the lack of peer interaction and peer-to-peer competition?
Okay, so socialization has always been an issue for a lot who look into homeschooling, but because it is a family lifestyle, it is a, you bring them wherever you go, you know, pre-pandemic, they have all the opportunities to learn through adults and through same age kids and through other children. If you have one child, an only child, if you do not live in an area with support groups, if you are far from, you know, you would have to find ways. And now it's through online, you know.
Yeah, another aspect I wanted to ask you about, as a parent myself, I don't want my kids spending too much time on the screen, you know, with a gadget.
Yeah.
But right now, with the way things are going, they're being drawn to the online world, even more so now. I mean, before it was just a resource. Now it's your education, everything.
Yeah.
How do you see that between kids needing to be online and, you know, all the research that needs to be done? How do you limit the time so that it's beneficial enough for them to learn, but not destructive enough for them to be on the gadget too much?
Okay. The American Academy of Pediatrics has this family screen guide. It's a family media plan, you know. And I think with you knowing what is required, what is the schedule of the Zoom classes, with a parent being deliberately, intentionally aware of what is required, you have to create a contract or an agreement with your children, you know. And there has to be some form of parent control that you'll probably put in your laptops or your you know, your screens, so that there is some form of control. You know, the predators are still there. All the online, you know, is, you know, they're all on high alert because they know everyone's on it. So again, it goes back to an agreement. You know, how I wish of course, all children had self-regulatory mechanisms where they know which sites are wrong or if they're spending too much time, but not all children have that. So the parents have to step in. But that has to come from knowing what is required in school, how many hours of being in Zoom, what is required for research and, you know, homework, and what allowances do you give for rewards for games and social media. And that has to be age appropriate. You know, it has to be age appropriate. And you have to be there to check it. Sorry, but, you know, just like you have to be there. Yeah.
Lastly, three tips that you would give to those that are embarking on this journey that you are on your 17th year of. Three tips.
Okay, first is you have to know why you're doing this. Of course, a lot are doing it because of the safety issue and the uncertainty of it. But I think to be able to thrive and bloom, you have to find a deeper why of why you're going to do this. Second is you have to get to know yourself and get to know your children. I mean, there is the beauty in delivering education where you know each other more and you have that as your ally. And three, if you are just be willing to learn. Be willing to learn from others. Be willing to learn from the experts and just be willing to learn from your children. And I think those are the three things that I can share.